everybody, and welcome to another episode of Radiorama, where I show you, as the name entails, how to work on radios, televisions, stereos, record players, anything that tends to run on glowing vacuum tubes. And today we have a Curtis Mathis stereo television system. I looked up the model and I wasn't really able to find this model. Granted, I didn't look as hard as I probably should. I've already removed the back so we can see the innards. We have, of course, the CRT, the television chassis. There's the can for the flyback. We have a set of 12-inch speakers with some little tweeters. And then we have a tuner and amplifier chassis. It is not push-pull, it's single-ended output, 6BQ5s, and someone opted to get the multiplex adapter, which is sitting loosely right here. This is why this tube is sitting higher. I gather that what you would have to do is you'd buy the kit and then plug in this socket to the 6BQ5 here to get the power. Curtis Mathis is kind of an interesting company. They were based out of Texas. They had, at one time, three manufacturing facilities. Then they centralized everything into one factory that might have been, I think it was in Dallas. They were one of the last American television manufacturers, continuing to manufacture right up until the late 80s. And Curtis Mathis was famous for a couple of things. Number one, they introduced one of the longest warranties for a television. The warranties on their televisions, I believe, were 4 years, which was unheard of because TVs back then were just simply not that reliable compared to how they are now. And later on, when they decided to go into solid state, they eventually devised a clever system where a repairman could come in and supposedly repair a set in under 20 minutes and have all the parts on hand. And what they did was they would divide the TV chassis into 12 individual components, including the CRT. So you'd have modules that clicked in, well, snapped into each other. And so if one part was bad on one module, you just replaced the whole thing. And so the repairman could come in and out of there, do a quick little bit of diagnostic, pinpoint it down to one of the modules, unplug the module, plug the new module in, be on his merry way. I have to admit, we tried this out last week and the tuner and amplifier part work fine. That's not a problem. We did get filament on the CRT, which is a good sign, and filaments on the TV chassis, but not much high voltage, very low high voltage. We did that by taking the cap off of this and running a screwdriver against the anode. I don't recommend you do that, but that's what we did. And confirmed there is a little bit of an arc, but not much. I kind of dig this transformer where they've put these gigantic cooling fins on it. And it looks like we have a manufacturing date on that transformer, October 11th, 1961. That goes with what little information I found about this model. This is supposedly a 1962 model. So what I'm going to do is remove this chassis. The first thing I want to do is remove some of the yellow, what do you call it, cadmium dust on the chassis, so I can handle it more. I don't really like the idea of handling powdery cadmium dust. And I'm also going to need to unplug everything. Let's see, how's this chassis held in? Okay, it's got bolts underneath there, so we will unloosen everything and put it up on the bench and investigate. And so it begins. I have cleaned off the chassis, actually cleaned up quite well. We'll start replacing these electrolytic capacitors. We have six total. There's three in each can. And then we have one here. Let's take a look underneath here. Ugh. Notice how neat and tidy everything is. It's all laid out in nice little terminal strips. These Sprague Black Beauties, they may or may not be plastic film caps. They're much better than the predecessor paper caps. So anyway, I'm gonna have to flip this upside down and we'll start replacing the electrolytic capacitors. Okay, so what we're going to do here, as mentioned, I'm gonna replace the capacitors that are inside of these electrolytics. It's interesting because these are Mallory's. Mallory definitely made some of the better capacitors, in my opinion. But you can see a little bit of puffing going here. There's a little bit of oozing. That indicates this capacitor is probably starting to swell up a little bit. So for good insurance, they should be replaced. You'll notice on the side they have these values. It's kind of hard to see. You'll have a shape, like a half moon, a square, a triangle. Each one denotes a value printed on the side of the can. And you can see here we have the triangle, the square, half moon shape. That indicates each value. And of course, I've already forgotten what the values were. Generally, what I will do is I will mark down what the values are with the shape and have it on a piece of paper. But we're going to replace all three of these values with three individual electrolytic capacitors. The same with this guy. And then we'll move our way over to this guy and replace him. It's only one capacitor. And then it's off to the boring task of replacing these shit ton of little black capacitors here. Okay, I got a little ahead of myself. I get distracted when I'm over here at the museum. But anyway, I have gotten a fair good start. We have all of our electrolytics replaced. I had to put two of these together because one of the values was 80 microfarad. So I put two 47 microfarad caps together. You can go over the microfarads. As long as you're at or over, you're fine. But the idea is I wanted to make sure everything was cinched up. These two guys, I used some silicone glue and also have a thick bus wire going to ground to keep them secured. And then I've been replacing these caps. We split one open and it is actually a mixture of paper and plastic, so not quite a pure plastic film cap, so those are iffy. We're going to replace all those. And so far I've replaced 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9 capacitors. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 more caps to go. Not too bad. I want to try to test this set before I leave the museum because there's some people that know more about television than I do. All right, so the recapping job is done. Actually didn't take that much time. I think it's because everything was so easy to get at. And you see I've got it on the bench here. It is at, you know, chest level. And it's a real shallow cabinet, so everything was super easy to get at. Now, there is one more issue I'm having, which is when I pulled the yoke connection off of the chassis, one of the wires was loose, and it's the red wire, probably meaning it's pretty critical, so it's not going to work without that, so I need to either do a sanity check to see where that goes to ascertain which connection that could be, or try to find a schematic, or consult one of the guys who are a lot smarter than me who volunteer here. So let's take it outside, get a variac. Confirm where the connection goes on the yoke and then see what happens. Okay, so I've put everything back into the cabinet. We're going to start off with a variac and put it at least at, why is that not registering anything? Let's see. Never mind. It'd help if I plugged the variac in. Okay, let's try that again. There we go. Power. Let's bring it up to about maybe 45-50%. See what I'm pulling in as far as draw. Not much. So far I don't hear or smell anything, so that's all promising. I feel like I just heard high voltage fire off. Televisions make me just a little bit nervous. Is this damn thing even on? I don't see any. Oh, I got filaments up here, I think. Let me look. I can't tell.
Turned on, Fisher.
All right, it's not on at all. Okay, the good news is that the CRT is strong and works. The bad news is that the whole thing is crooked. I don't know what that's about, but maybe one of the television gurus over there can help me. Guys. Okay, so turn the yoke a little bit. The yoke being this thingy here, and it'll straighten it up a little bit. We do have a little bit of issue with some of the horizontal not filling up the screen. There's probably an adjustment in the back, because right here it's ending there and here. By the way, this is key. Whenever you've powered up a set, you want to make sure that you discharge the CRT. That's crucial. So you ground, I get a screwdriver, and you're going to stick it underneath this rubber plunger and touch the anode. I'm not going to do this one-handed because it's pretty critical that I pay attention. Okay, I've brought it up on the Variac. We have a signal going through the CRT. And we have picture for sure. It's not quite filling up the screen. What the hell just happened? Did I just lose the picture? Okay, we did the math, and basically we were missing a 5K resistor. It opened up. And so now we have good, solid CRT. I know this is not showing up on video. Seems to be working pretty good. You're good. For some reason, half the radio museum decided they were very excited about this, so we're all working on it together. Takes like a village.
Some things are just cool.
Yes. All right, welcome to day number two of working on the Curtis Mathis television stereo, and kind of want to apologize. The first day was just kind of nuts. That always happens when I tend to start working on things at the museum. There's 10,000 people, and of course, they're all very excited about working on electronics, just like me, and so I left out a lot of the details. I want to kind of go over some of those details. First of all, Kyle, one of our newer members, actually he's starting to become one of our established members, he went over and went through the record player. Record player and the changer and all that are in great shape. This is ready to go. I did oil the sliders for the drawer. The TV, as you saw, is working fantastic. We did a few small things to kind of give it a little more nice detail. We took this trim piece off. This glass comes out, and we were able to clean the mask and all that. A lot of television sets in the earlier parts, in the 50s, maybe even early 60s, they'd put a piece of tempered glass in front of the CRT. They hadn't quite figured out the implosion technology. So if the CRT did implode, not a bad idea to have a piece of safety glass in front to contain shrapnel. Now, I've removed all the knobs because the next stage of this process is going to be taking out the tuner and amplifier chassis. They're built into one unit, which is this unit here. And there's also a multiplex adapter that needs to be overhauled. Whoever installed it kind of made this mess. I'm going to clean that up a little bit. Going over what happened with the TV chassis. Now, it was fully recapped, and there was a power resistor that was associated with these two tubes. Essentially the tubes that are responsible for generating the amount of high voltage needed to fire that CRT. We lost that. Turned out to be a 5,000 ohm, 10 watt resistor that replaced that, and so we fully got full functioning television capacity, as you saw before. So the next stage is again to rebuild this chassis. I'm sorry for the sunlight getting in the way. I don't suspect this is going to be terribly complicated as far as getting this out. I can feel there's some bolts underneath, so I'll probably push the record player out so I can get my drivers underneath here. And what do we have here? Leaves, probably from being in the back of my truck. So let's get this out of here, detach the speaker terminals and all the other stuff, all the cabling, and take a look underneath. I get a sneaking suspicion it's going to be similar. We'll probably have some of those black Bakelite caps, maybe some ceramic caps. There's one electrolytic on the chassis here. And what does it say? 60, 30, and 100 microfarads. And this probably has a couple of values in this can right here. We also want to make sure and attach this versus it being like it is now, which is just sitting here generically and loosely. Probably want to also try to see if we can clean the turret controls on the channel changing mechanism up there. This should be a rather sensitive radio. We have a pretty big tuning gang up here. I'm assuming or thinking that maybe FM is going to most likely have a separate tuning mechanism underneath the chassis. I'm not sure if it's slug or if it's just another fin-based tuning condenser. We'll see. Okay, so I pulled the tuner and amp chassis and its multiplex adapter. This was clearly a option that someone got later, as seen by this jerry-rigged soldering job here, and the fact that it was just sitting in there loosely. That's okay, it has screw holes, so we can mount it in there permanently. Noticed all the tubes in it are possibly original. They have the same script, the same Curtis Mathis script. Of course, probably Curtis Mathis did not make their own tubes. And they have someone else made it, and they just put their names on it. It does have three electrolytic capacitors. We have a 60, a 30, and a 100. And it's more than likely chassis ground. We have a 100 microfarad cap rated at 15 volts. That's probably some sort of bias or something. No big deal. So what I'll do is I'll mark down which shape means what. So then I flip it over and I see the embossed shapes underneath this. I'll know what goes where. Let's take a look underneath here. It's remarkably not very complicated. We have, of course, the underside of the electrolytic here with our three values. And then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 caps that need to be replaced. We actually took these guys apart, and I'm not sure if I mentioned this, but they are a mixture of paper and plastic film. So it's iffy. It's cheap insurance to replace them. The rest of these are all ceramic caps. Those usually are just fine. You don't need to deal with those things. They tend to be fine unless you physically damage them. Other than that, there's not much to do. So there's basically a total of 10 caps need to be replaced, and then we need to clean all of these controls, even though it seemed to be working okay before we took it apart. This is not going to be what I'd call a fire-breathing amplifier. It only has single-ended 6BQ5s for the output. It's not push-pull. If you had four, in other words, two per channel, that'd be much more output power, but then again, the speakers in this weren't exactly thrilling either, so it's fine. I mean, it's going to sound okay. It's not going to be an audiophiles piece. I'm sure, you know, the appeal of this is strictly in its design and the fact that the TV works really well. So that for someone that wants, you know, that look, the Jetsons television look, this will be it. So let's go ahead and mark down those electrolytic values for the shapes, and we'll replace those first. And then we'll start digging into these guys. Okay, so the electrolytics are replaced. Electrolytics. I realized I said that too fast. Anyhow, I have my own methods of installing parts, and some people will insist that you need to install a terminal strip for your ground. But what I do is I find grounds that already exist on the chassis. It's especially easy when you have a chassis ground. You can just relocate things however you please and keep your connections real nice and short. You know, so nothing's going to move around. That's just as good as installing a terminal strip. Is it as pretty? No, but no one's going to look under here anyway. The third one, the 100 microfarad cap, goes over here. my tip also, you don't really ever want to have your caps leaning up against a resistor. You just need a little bit of an air gap. It helps. This just has a giant hole up here, so that's going to get even more ventilation. So now it's time to start replacing these little guys, and they will have their markings on the side. 0.047 rated at 400 volts max. It's probably way less than that, but we have our values written on their sides. And again, how many, let me clear my throat, sorry. How many do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 caps. So let's get recapping on that and then clean the volume and control pots. Okay, so we've got everything replaced here. All new nice yellow capacitors. So now it's time to start cleaning some of the controls here. Let me see how easy those are to turn. They're fine. All right, so let me get this light out of the way. And I'm gonna start spraying it down the behind the wiper here. You see where there's kind of a slot here where these three leads go in? You wanna get the juice down in there. Not sure if you can see that. Don't be afraid to flood it. We're just gonna get rid of whatever debris might have built up on this pot over the years. Probably not much as it's inside and facing upside down, which is what makes sense. Well, that is starting to run out, so it's time to get a new can. Okay, let's start spraying that. And again, that's starting to work in pretty well. Let's get this other one. Again, we want to work that in. There's probably some pots up top for the television. Vertical hold or horizontal. Maybe not, actually that's maybe part of the tuning turret. I didn't quite look. Okay, we also need to get this, but I can't turn that without a knob, so I'll get a knob. Put a knob on it. You want to spray these wafers and click this back and forth a whole bunch to make sure and clear all of your contacts. All right, so now it's time to oil the tuning condenser. So I get in my little oiler here with my Zoom spout oil. I'm going in for all of the little areas that rubs. And then I just want to like touch the pulleys. It's like a tiny drop. And what I'm going to do also is run a kind of a bead of oil over this slide here. Then we get a paper towel and wipe that down real good. Make sure it's going to go back real good and easily. I'll also oil the pivot joint down here. Usually what you can do for this is kind of put a little oil in there, and by capillary action it will soak into that seam. It's already a lot easier to turn. But I'll wipe this down up top here. And then I think I'm probably done for the electronics tonight. I might choose to clean this glass, but otherwise I'm going to go back to the cabinet, because I usually spend about 1 to 2 hours on electronics, and then I split the time going back to the cabinet. It's nice to mix things up a little bit. All right, so now it's time to return my attention to the cabinet. Is it perfect? No, unfortunately it's got evidence of probably someone set a plant up here. In fact, there was probably a bunch of things that sat on top of it. I'm kind of like, so what? It's an old piece of furniture. Things happen. So I'm going to try to do my best to make it look the best it can in the condition it's in. I've already applied a few applications of oil and Old English and other stuff. In fact, you probably saw previously some of my fine friends were over here the other night. They were helping me clean it up. Well, we did an initial pass, but I really want to kind of deep clean, scrub, and do some fine cleaning work. In fact, you can see here, this is obviously much brighter than this. This is probably nicotine stain and years of Junior's grubby little hands like handling the knobs and everything. So we need to make sure and clean that up real well. Likewise, the woodwork needs to get cleaned up some more. Just the little details like that is where it really adds up to making a fully refurbished piece. I even have gone in and cleaned the interior of the cabinet. Is that necessary? No. But why not? You're in there. It's not been open probably for 50 years. Might as well do it inside and out. All right, welcome to day 3 of working on the Curtis Mathis. And I think I forgot to film this last night. I was tired. I went over the case and cabinet, rather, with Howard's feed and wax, which is, I think it's beeswax with some sort of petroleum product. I've put probably about 2 or 3 helpings of this material on the cabinet. It is a product that you want to wipe the excess off when it's had a chance to soak in, which it certainly has. I'm probably going to go over the top with some Caranuba wax. I think the front and the sides are fine as is. I just want to make sure that this does not really dry out, because there was certainly some dryness to the finish. I was able to tease out a little bit more of those imperfections. It's too bad because the rest of the set is perfect. I cleaned the metal escutcheon here, and I also subsequently cleaned and polished the knobs here. This is the combination fine tune and channel changing knob. I used a little Novus plastic polish. I buy this stuff by the jug full. And I also cleaned up all the billions of little knobs that are in the front. So now with that said, it's time to rebuild the last electronic chassis here. And that is the stereo decoder. Stereo decoder means this is decoding, or basically getting a FM stereo signal. It says, do not remove. But that's exactly what I am going to do. I'm going to fold these little flaps out of the way. We have an electrolytic mounted up top here. And what does it say? It says, I think it's a single value. 40 microfarads. That's it. Probably not much else to speak of. There's probably maybe a couple of paper caps inside. But just like anything, it's this era. Should be replaced. I've been talking to a few people online about this brand, and there's mixed feelings. Some people say it's really cheap. It's a really cheap brand. I don't deny that there's some cheapness to it. It's not the worst I've ever seen. The fact that they're using Mallory capacitors, that's good quality. And I've seen some cheap manufacturers that used crappier electrolytics, but the fact that they're using Mallory's here, it's pretty good. That's probably why it still worked. All right, so let's peel the bottom off of this and see what's going on underneath besides that puppy. All right, so here we go. A little bit more going on than I thought, but anyway, we have 2 paper caps, this guy and the one buried underneath there. And then of course we have the electrolytic. This is the bottom of it. Single value, 40 microfarads. The rest of the caps in here are either ceramic or like this. This is a polystyrene cap. Those are fine. When you see them, they're clear. It's a plastic film cap. There's no paper. And so there's not much to replace in this one either. I'm kind of curious. This must just be powered off of 6 volts, period, because it was coming off of the... Well, I'm curious. What is going on in this thing? Because we have 4 wires. I'm assuming 1 and 6 volt. I'd have to not be lazy and look out the pinout on the 6BQ5, because I'm assuming it must be drawing whatever volts are coming off of, or whatever voltage is coming off those pins, because we have 4 pins involved here. 2 brown, well actually I have 3 wires. One of them's bound to be 6 volts for the filaments. Maybe we have a B plus on one of the others. This is obviously the ground. Curious. Okay, so I got this guy recapped. Not exactly the most impressive thing ever. Just 3 caps we're talking about, so I'll split the bottom back on. And then I believe it's going to be time to do a addition of a stereo input. We have a tape player selection. We got 2 RCAs here. So I think I just might run a cable out here. And that way someone can plug in something else in case they decide maybe they want to run their TV set through it or something. Usually I put a 3.5 millimeter. I realized I made a dumb comment. Why would anyone watch, I don't know, TV on another TV when they have a TV? Blah. Never mind. You get what I'm about to say. I need to run an audio input through here. And then we're going to go over and start reassembling. See if we can get this bad boy back together again. I was about to put the chassis back in. I realized I'd forgotten to clean the pots on the TV. Whatever you call it, mechanism. So I have to get in here with my cleaner. I can't film it at the same time, but all these pots up here need to be cleaned. And is it turret tuning? Yes, it's turret. Anyway, I'll clean those suckers up and then we'll start reassembly. Okay, I have to admit I had kind of a stupid problem and I was too embarrassed to film it. Anyway, I lost a channel. Basically, when my right channel wasn't working. And I was looking here. And somehow I have touched these two leads together. I think that's what the problem is. So I'm going to get that out of the way. Make sure nothing else is touching. Not a bad idea, you know, after you've done a major overhaul, just to make sure that nothing you have done is touching anything critical, or that you remembered all the leads that needed to be connected. I think we're good here. I don't see anything really touching per se. I'm hoping that was what the problem was right there. Because what was happening is when I pulled this tube, which is the 12AX7, the other channel would sort of come back alive, which meant something was getting pulled down. All right. Other than a tube having gone bad, which I don't think is the case, I can't think of anything else that could cause me to lose that channel. So I'll plug it back in. Hopefully we solved the problem. Okay. 80s plus at 103.7. Looks like we're much better shape now. We have right and left channel. That makes me very happy. I was a little worried there for a minute. It's like, what did I do? So now let's put this mess back in the cabinet and button things up. Okay, so the TV and the stereo and all the other jazz seems to be working pretty well. I'm actually pretty impressed with the picture on this thing. I know that probably this video looks weird because they're out of sync. But it's got a, I think, a relatively good sharp picture, and it's still sunny out here in the garage. So the fact that I can see this clearly, that's a pretty good sign. I think I better wrap up for the evening. There's a few other little fine touches I want to do on this, but I think for now I am done for the evening. I'll resume on this tomorrow.
Here's the bill. Yeah, let the time run out.
Hey, throw it right in my face. You're wearing Mr. Grover's badge, why don't you give it to him?
Oh, this land here.
Blood money. Graft. Mr. Grover said it goes with the job.
Sound interesting. Good size pop.
Okay. I've moved back to the cabinet. I am going to use a cleaner paste wax to clean up the surface here. I just did a little bit of test and you can see how dirty and filthy that is. So my hope is to gently lift a lot of the grubbiness from the top. This is a cleaner car renewal wax. I usually just take my time. You can generally brighten up this surface to bring out all of the contaminants and get a much more closer to the original finish than would have, you know, if you didn't do anything. Well, it is probably officially the last day of me working on the Curtis Mathis. I did do a little bit of Carnauba waxing of the top to try to even things out a little bit and also make sure that that finish stays nice and sealed in. I did a few more fine tweaks to the controls. I was having a little bit of contact issues with the turret here, so I went in there with some cleaner And other than putting the back on, there's not much else to do. I kind of was taking my sweet time on this because I enjoyed working on it so much, because I'm most of the stuff I work on tends to be 5-tube radios, and there's 5 gazillion of those out there. And I did make a dumb mistake last night when I was putting this back in. I actually lost a channel and I could not figure out what it was. And what it was is, when I put it back in, I nicked the top off of one of the output tubes and it went to air. So I had to put another one in it. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to do another just test to make sure everything's working as it should. And then it'll be time to put the back on. And I think what I'm going to do after that is let it sit and run for a while. It's a little more complicated with televisions. If something's going to go wrong, I'd rather it go wrong here versus me having to go out to someone's house, whoever in the future procures this, and have to do a repair there. I'd rather it be a long-term fix. I was told by many people online that they did not exactly care for this brand, that there were failure points with certain things like the rotary switches and the flybacks. This one seems to be working okay. It seemed like, from the opinion that some people said, is that as the brand proceeded to go into the future, especially when they started using import chassis, that the quality started to go down. My assessment is it's not that bad, in my opinion. It's, I don't know, dare I say, maybe about Magnavox type quality. I know some people love Magnavox. They're okay. This is okay as well. I need to charge up my Bluetooth module and make sure that the audio input works for the tape, and then we'll call it done. You know, I had 2 of these, and now they're gone.
Quit. Davis, and help him get away or take any part of that money. You become an accessory to the crime.
I know this is not filming right, but the picture actually looks pretty good.
How are you going to take me to him?
And it's pretty bright and sunny in the garage. But anyway, it's working pretty well now.
All right.
Had a little bit of problems with some of the contacts in the turret, so I had to clean the turrets a little bit. Anyway, I'm just going to let it play here for a little while, and then I'll put the back on, and then I'll call it done. I could not find my Bluetooth adapter. It's somewhere. They're tiny. I need to make a keychain or something for it so that it doesn't, I don't get to lose it. But anyway, that's about as good of the quality as you're going to get for a TV of this era. I mean, you know, I don't think I would choose to watch Netflix on it for sure. But if you want a vintage TV and you like old movies, well, here you go. It works pretty well. Okay, I'm calling it on this guy. Had it run for about an hour. Didn't really have any problems on the TV. Seems to be working good and cleanly. Now I have it on stereo. Well, not stereo, duh. I have it on FM. All right, let's put it on record player, FM, multiplex, phono, and I'm doing exactly what Kyle told me not to do.
I got a right to sit and cry.
should turn itself off. No record detected. Off! There we go! Okay, well, I had a lot of fun working on this one. I wish I had like 5 more of these to work on, because they sure are more exciting than what I usually work on. I think this will be an interesting piece for somebody, for sure. I kind of almost wish we could just keep it at the museum, but I've been told we don't have the room for such a large piece. So, poo! I'd keep it myself. Well, I'd buy it myself if it weren't for the fact. I also don't have room. I've got a house full of consoles. Certainly don't need this. Thanks so much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, I'll try to get to them down below. Things are a little weird for me right now. I'm week number 2 into a new job, so I'm just figuring things out. The schedule's a little funny. But I'll try to get to them if I can, and thanks so much for watching. So until the next time something comes across the workbench, I'll see you guys next time. Adios.